This fuse box needs replacing and moving to a new position. So as electricians, that means we need to look at the cable runs and can we re-divert those cables into that new position. Within here, I have 7 circuits, and on investigation, those cables will not be long enough for the new location. So in this video, I'm going to use the Wiska Consumer Unit Relocation Kit. And as I open it up, you're going to think exactly the same as me. I'm thinking Elton John. I'm thinking Tupac, and I'm thinking ghetto gospel. In other words, the collaboration of 2 great singers to make 1 great song. And that's what we've got here. We've got the Wiska enclosure. We've got the TOPJOB dim rail connectors from Wago, or as we like to call it here on the channel, Vargo, coming together in order that we can extend these circuits. But as we're talking about collaborations, this is going to require me to do a little bit of work. So I'm going to need some help as well. Rick!
As you've just heard, Gary's shouting me for some work. He's just passed me the Consumer Unit Relocation Kit from Wiska. Want to stick around, let's see how I did it.
So before Rick gets underway in disconnecting all the conductors in here, just to confirm we're fully isolated, and we'd love your comments. So what's wrong with this consumer unit? Okay, so I'm sure there's a massive list of things that you want to add into the comments. And Rick's going to now mark up the cables ready for disconnecting. And again, your feedback would be very welcome about the disconnection process. So how do you label up your conductors so you know what they are when they've left the consumer unit? We've already had a discussion off camera. So Rick is actually going to label up the 6mm squared twin and CPC cable in the board, whereas I probably wouldn't because there is only one of them, but he's got his own system and he's going to use a system of numbers and lines, I think, in order that he can work out where his cables are going to be in the next part of the installation process. So how many have you got in here, Rick?
I've got 7 circuits.
Okay, so that last one's going to have a few lines on it. Are you going to identify the protective bonding conductor to the water there with 12 lines on it or something like that, green and yellow one?
No.
Okay, so you're going to leave that one. So the process there of putting the marks on, important because obviously we need to arrange them into our extension box. And there we go. So that's fully labelled up, ready for the disconnection next. So disconnecting all 7 circuits before we can put on the Wiska Consumer Unit Relocation Kit. And it's got the ability to extend 10 circuits and we've only got 7, but how many of those top jobs are we actually going to use?
Yeah, we're going to be using 9 sets because of the rings that we've got here. So we've got the 2 connections that we need, both legs of the ring that are going to need connecting through. So each one of these is going to be a set, as with this one. So because of that, we're going to need to use 9 sets.
So dim rails coming off. I do like the quick release ones where you only have to back them off. I think you've got to take both screws out on this one, have you?
Yeah, I do, yeah. And once this is off, I can present it back to the front of the cover and marry up the numbers with the labelling that's actually on the board.
So number 1 being, say, the cooker circuit, by bringing the 2 together, you know exactly what it is.
Exactly, yeah.
Okay, that's really good. And as I look up here, this is the time that I would say to the customer when my invoice is due, because obviously there is no electricity on. And obviously the Wi-Fi is not working. It looks like a lot of cables have got to be reconnected. Final bit of getting the conductors removed. See, those marks are going to help you in a little while. So we can pull that all forward, are we?
Yeah.
Not a very big gap there to get it through. Someone's made a decent job of installing it in the first place, apart from all the things we've listed in the comments that we didn't like. Okay,
so just straighten that up so hopefully it passes through that little letterbox.
Okay, we're probably going to change the order around a bit when we get to the next stage. So that's ready to come off the wall now, yeah? So let's see if we can get it off. Yeah. A lot going on in there, isn't it? Oh, it's got the wrong screwdriver. Is that your slotted posi you were trying to use there, was it?
Yeah.
Comment below how many times you've done that. Pulled the slotted posi out and trying to work it into a screw. Give it to the apprentice. That's always a classic one, isn't it?
And it's at this point. I wish I had my drill handy.
Okay, yeah, using the old that's another thing to comment, would you, at this stage it doesn't really matter what you're using because actually it's coming off the wall and not being used again. So some of those things we've mentioned in other videos may have been used. I won't mention that word, I'll let you mention it in the comments. But yeah, there's other ways of getting these screws undone, but of course because it's Rick doing it, I like him to go a little bit old school. So he's having to use the old wrist action there to get it off. So off comes the board, final screw coming out, and you've just got to wiggle it out. I always like it when the next one's on. So when all those cables are either in a consumer unit, which we're not doing now because we're doing the relocation kit, but it's when they get back into the new enclosure I feel comfortable, because that's the bit where I'm just dressing and terminating cables. But this time I'm going to be watching you do it, Rick, so I've got to get these out. I'm going to be a bit forceful now in order to get this out. There we go. Right, let's come off the tree. Come on. Lovely. Yeah, okay, so the Wiska relocation enclosure now needs a little bit of fabrication in order to get the cables in, and you just pop in some of the top job dim rail connectors out the way. What are you doing that for, Rick?
Yeah, just so I can remove the the full rail here to allow me to manufacture the entry and exit points within there, and obviously just clear out any debris that might be left behind.
Well, good thinking. So as that comes off then, I think I'm noticing that's probably made of plastic rather than the normal metal DIN rail that I'm used to seeing. What's the thinking behind it being plastic?
Yeah, just to prevent any continuity, because you see on these on the earth connectors, they're a metallic connecting point here. And if it were, well, it's just to prevent any continuity.
So what we're saying there is if it was a metal DIN rail connection at the back, all the CPCs within here would be linked together, and we're in the consumer doing some testing, we actually wouldn't have our CPCs for individual circuits going out because we would have linked them all together there. I noticed that it was rather high within the enclosure. Could I put it in any of the other holes?
Yeah, so around here you can see there's a lot of fixing points. So you can fix to either of them or in a different orientation. However, we've got some raised section here which would foul on the DIN rail.
So we'd probably have to do a little bit of an adjustment there as well. The reason why it is slightly higher is because you could have a different style of Vargo TOPJOB dim rail connectors. We've got the ones here with the levers on the back sections here, and obviously this makes it a little bit lower. So of course they've kept all of their rails in the same position, and it could be that you had this one returned to you, or you could have the one that we're using here with the push, and you'll see that when we go through the full connecting process. So you're going to mark it up now in order that you can cut out a large slot in the top. I'm noting locations for holes all around this Wiska enclosure. When am I likely to be using those, Rick?
Yeah, you can use any of these if it were on a surface mounted installation. So you could pop these out, stick in some Wiska glands. We're actually going to take this one out and use it to pass through our cables with some trunking in this position. Then on the top side here, because it comes through the back, we're just going to take out a small section, which allows us to bring the cables into.
You drilled a series of holes there. What's the thinking behind that?
Yeah, so when I flip this over to cut it out, I can actually see the areas I need to mark up, and then I can get the multi-tool out, cut along them lines, and then with a bit of luck, I don't crash into anything else.
Okay, because there is a supporting structure there for obviously the side of the lid, isn't there? Yeah, so that section's going to come out so our cables can come into it. And you said on the bottom side, you're going to just drill out that hole, are you?
Yeah, so I'm going to take out this hole here. As we're using trunking, I'm just going to move it ever so slightly down, which just allows us to fill up that section there.
So taking your time here to get it marked up correctly, so in order to get those cuts put into place. Is it time for the multi-tool?
Yeah, I think we're just about ready there.
So you've arranged your conductors as they come through the old cables and the number order that you're happy with. So you need to try and give yourself the right order when you're into the enclosure. I always think this is the worst bit, once you've got them in and it's on the wall. We're going to be making off those connections, which of course, because they're going into Vargo connectors, will be really, really easy. We'll see that in a few moments as those cables go in. And you said you're coming out the bottom with a mini trunking.
Yep.
So the cables will need to be identified at that end as well. Is that right? Have you identified the cables that are going to be extending?
I have, yeah. I've done exactly the same, where I've put the numbering system on the other end so they can pair up.
Okay, so through they go. So through through they go. This is the bit we all like when it just wiggles itself back onto the surface. Okay, yeah.
There we go. Fix it back to the wall and jobs are good.
Nice use of the spirit level, Rick. Don't want any wonky Joe moments, do we, as we get that on the wall. Is there any caps to cover those screws up?
There is, yeah.
Okay, so we'll pop those on. So you're going to place the DIN rail and you're going to now go for the middle section, aren't you? You're going to middle the box to give you equal amount of room either side.
I am, yeah. I know I said earlier that we've got these sections here that foul, but just to give myself a little bit more room, I'm still going to connect to these centre points.
Okay, so you're going to be able to fit it on there and it will go on, obviously, with no issues. Now, when I was looking at the instructions for the box, it says it's IP65 and I thought, well, that doesn't really matter, does it? And then it made me think about some of those electrical installations that I've seen over the years where the consumer unit is, say, up a step towards the front door, mounted on the wall outside of the property, but not actually physically out in the elements, and an IP65 box would be perfect for that. Or maybe between two terrace properties where there was like an alley that separated those properties. Again, the metering equipment's there, and often you could also see a consumer unit in that location. Again, if that was being relocated within the building, the IP65 element of this enclosure would be perfect when it's located in those two situations. So that's it. So we're down to the exciting bit now, are we, Rick? We're finally going to make our terminations into our TOPJOB Vargo DIN rail connectors. I've turned away for a second and you've already got the first ring final circuit I see connected in. So as I'm looking at these TOPJOBs and the smaller ones to start with, what's the current rating of these, Rick?
So these smaller ones, they're rated at 32 amps. Now then, there is a limit to the sizing. These ones will go up to 4 mil. Now then, that's on a solid conductor. If you were to use a fine stranded conductor, it would then reduce to 2.5.
Okay.
As we move over to the larger ones, these are rated at 76 amps. They will go up to 16 mil on a solid conductor, but then comes down to a 10 mil on a fine stranded conductor.
Well, they're all perfect for us because we've got nothing bigger than that. So let's see you connect one of these. So it must be easy because of how quick you've done it. So cutting it to length, you're going to strip it off. Is it between 10 and 12 mil?
It is, yeah.
Okay, and then strip those off. And it's a simple case of pushing it into position. It only needs the special tool, doesn't it, to release them. You'll show me that tool in a minute. So you just push it into position and that's it in. Dress it round to make that connection. Right, okay. So once that's in and say I need to take it out, maybe I'm doing some fault finding. How do I release it?
Yes, we get the tool.
Okay, and that's an operating tool, not a screwdriver, is it?
The operating tool.
Okay, you press it.
Pop that in. And it releases this.
Okay, and it says it's solid conductor, you can just push it straight in. See that? Look at that, straight in, yeah, connected. Wow, that is a quick process. We're racing along here, so is this a lighting circuit we're installing?
It is, yeah, just putting the last one in for that.
And CPC's in. I think we can say that, you know, we said it in the intro, a fantastic collaboration. This is Wiska and Wago coming together to make a product that makes electricians' life easier, and we love that at eFIXX, don't we? So we should have this done in no time, Rick. It's all the preparation that takes all the time, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, I suppose that's like with anything though, isn't it? A bit of time spent prior will save you a bit of time in the future.
It also looks pretty neat. Now, it'd be interesting to see if you're the sort of person that would probably put numbered connections either side of these DIN rail connectors and again, repeat those in the consumer unit. That would be a lovely comment and feedback below if you think that's worthwhile. Obviously, if there is some fault finding, you may find you're opening this enclosure and testing from here. We're going to leave a nice labelled section in the lid itself, aren't we, with all our connections so we know what they're doing.
We are, yeah.
So this is one of the bigger ones. So this is the 6mm one. It's going to be popped in today. Let's see how easy this is. Yeah, equally as easy as before. Now, what are you going to do with your protective bonding conductor? Everyone's going to be talking about that one poking up there at the corner. What's going to happen with that, Rick?
It's going to be jointed in the middle.
Okay, so you can put it in that green one just there, bang in the centre.
Into the green one here.
Yeah, now this is a question for the audience and one that we will get, hopefully, Joe Robinson to answer in a technical Q&A. Can you join the protective bonding conductor? If so, is this method of connection one that would be allowed? So we'd love your comments there. However, in this installation, the protective bonding conductor goes to a water pipe and the incoming material is plastic, so we're just going to leave it in there and not extend it through because it is not an extraneous conductive part, so we're going to leave it within this enclosure. But we'd love your thoughts on that one. Can you join the protective bonding conductor if you wanted to extend it? So we've still got another set to obviously make off on the outgoing side, but what's your thoughts so far then, Rick?
I'm really impressed with it, to be quite honest. Yeah, I really like it. Once it's all set up and ready to go, it's a bit of a doddle.
Oh, as recommended by eFIXX, quote, Rick says it's a doddle. I like it. I can see the posters now, Rick.
Yeah.
There we go. So, yeah, just a couple more to go and then we'll concentrate on the bottom. So we've got the mini trunking up and we're making the connections now to the extended board. What number are you on at the minute as you pull
this
that cable off?
This is number 6.
So it's labelled both ends number 6 and you're going to put it into the appropriate place on the DIN rail. It's looking good, Rick. It's looking good.
Thank you.
So just a case of dressing them round and extending those cables through. And we'll be almost at the labelling up stage. Let's see you connect this one up. Obviously in with the side cutters, strip it back to approximately 12 mil, and then we'll insert it in. You got all the gear in you?
Spoil.
Yeah, you are. I'm glad you said that. Saved me saying it. Okay, so we're stripped. We don't double them over into here, so there's no need to. So we push them straight in. There we go, connected. That's another one starting the extending process. So the final conductor to go in, and that is finished. That looks pretty good. And our overall feelings are, yeah, that we like it. It was pretty simple, but as always, it's your comments. Have you used one of these before? Please leave it below. If you've got any top tips when using it as well, we'd be really interested in your feedback as Rick connects his final neutral conductor, and then we're off to see that printed label that we've got on the inside of the lid next. So we're all completed then. It's just this labeling we'll only take a little look at that you've done down here. So that's pretty similar to what we saw in the consumer unit at the start. So the first three are leg one of the ring final circuit and then leg two, so same ring final circuit for downstairs, that makes logical sense. And then we work through what the blank one there, cooker, lights, immersion heater, and then the other leg of the ring, which matches to what we've got up here. We'll also put a label on the front of it explaining what the box is doing as well. And that's it, all finished. But as always, it's your thoughts and comments that drive us on. Please leave all them below and I'll let Rick get back to all of them.